Welcome, everyone, and thank you for joining this webinar on the 60th anniversary of President Kennedy's American University speech. This webinar is sponsored by the JFK Peace Speech Committee of Massachusetts Peace Action. My name is Martin Schatz, and I'll be coordinating this event along with my colleague, Amar Ahmad. The JFK Peace Speech Committee is dedicated to spreading awareness and understanding of JFK's speech as widely as possible. If you agree on the value of this speech, we hope you will join in this effort. We want people to invite family, friends, and neighbors into their homes to watch the speech and discuss it. We want houses of worship, city and town councils to sponsor showings and discussions of the speech. We want students in high school, colleges, and universities to see the speech. You can reach our committee by emailing info@masspeaceaction.org, or you can email me directly. I'll put my email and the info@masspeaceaction.org into the chat. Our committee has developed various educational materials on this topic that we're happy to share. And we'll be recording this event, and everyone who's registered will receive a link along with other materials in the near future. If you want help connecting with others in your area who are also interested in this speech, you can put your location and email in the chat, and we will try and connect you. The agenda for today is to watch President Kennedy delivering his address. This will be followed by some remarks from Professor Jeffrey Sachs and a discussion with him that will in total last for about an hour. He will be joining us from Europe. Our program will conclude with a video of selections from a new musical work by Sharon Abreu that was inspired by the speech. So without further delay, let's watch President Kennedy.
We strive to make others see. I have therefore chosen this time and place to discuss a topic on which ignorance too often abounds and the truth too rarely perceived, and that is the most important topic on earth, peace. What kind of a peace do I mean, and what kind of a peace do we seek? Not a Pax Americana enforced on the world by American weapons of war. Not the peace of the grave or the security of the slave. I am talking about genuine peace, the kind of peace that makes life on earth worth living, the kind that enables men and nations to grow and to hope and build a better life for their children. Not merely peace for Americans, but peace for all men and women. Not merely peace in our time, but peace in all time. I speak of peace because of the new face of war. Total war makes no sense in an age where great powers can maintain large and relatively invulnerable nuclear forces and refuse to surrender without resort to those forces. It makes no sense in an age where a single nuclear weapon contains almost 10 times the explosive force delivered by all the Allied air forces in the Second World War. It makes no sense in an age when the deadly poisons produced by a nuclear exchange would be carried by wind and water and soil and seed to the far corners of the globe and to generations yet unborn. Today, the expenditure of billions of dollars every year on weapons acquired for the purpose of making sure we never need them is essential to the keeping of peace. But surely the acquisition of such idle stockpiles, which can only destroy and never create, is not the only, much less the most efficient, means of assuring peace. I speak of peace, therefore, as the necessary rational end of rational men. I realize the pursuit of peace is not as dramatic as the pursuit of war, and frequently the words of the pursuers fall on deaf ears, but we have no more urgent task. Some say that it is useless to speak of peace or world law or world disarmament, and that it will be useless until the leaders of the Soviet Union adopt a more enlightened attitude. I hope they do. I believe we can help them do it. But I also believe that we must re-examine our own attitudes as individuals and as a nation, for our attitude is as essential as theirs. And every graduate of this school, every thoughtful citizen who despairs of war and wishes to bring peace, should begin by looking inward, by examining his own attitude towards the possibilities of peace, towards the Soviet Union, towards the course of the Cold War, and towards freedom and peace here at home. First, examine our attitude towards peace itself. Too many of us think it is impossible. Too many think it is unreal. But that is a dangerous, defeatist belief. It leads to the conclusion that war is inevitable, that mankind is doomed, that we are gripped by forces we cannot control. We need not accept that view. Our problems are man-made. Therefore, they can be solved by man, and man can be as big as he wants. No problem of human destiny is beyond human beings. Man's reason and spirit have often solved the seemingly unsolvable, and we believe they can do it again. I am not referring to the absolute, infinite concept of universal peace and goodwill, of which some fantasies and fanatics dream. I do not deny the value of hopes and dreams, but we merely invite discouragement and incredulity by making that our only and immediate goal. Let us focus instead on a more practical, more attainable peace, based not on a sudden revolution in human nature, but on a gradual evolution in human institutions, on a series of concrete actions and effective agreements which are in the interests of all concerned. There is no single simple key to this peace, no grand or magic formula to be adopted by one or two powers. Genuine peace must be the product of many nations, the sum of many acts. It must be dynamic, not static, changing to meet the challenge of each new generation. For peace is a process, a way of solving problems. With such a peace, there will still be quarrels and conflicting interests, as there are within families and nations. World peace, like community peace, does not require that each man love his neighbor. It requires only that they live together in mutual tolerance, submitting their disputes to a just and peaceful settlement. And history teaches us that enmities between nations, as between individuals, do not last forever. However fixed our likes and dislikes may seem, the tide of time and events will often bring surprising changes in the relations between nations and neighbors. So let us persevere. Peace need not be impractical, and war need not be inevitable. By defining our goal more clearly, by making it seem more manageable and less remote, we can help all people to see it, to draw hope from it, and to move irresistibly towards it. And second, let us re-examine our attitude towards the Soviet Union. It is discouraging to think that their leaders may actually believe what their propagandists write. It is discouraging to read a recent authoritative Soviet text on military strategy and find on page after page wholly baseless and incredible claims, such as the allegation that American imperialist circles are preparing to unleash different types of war, that there is a very real threat of a preventative war being unleashed by American imperialists against the Soviet Union, and that the political aims, and I quote, of the American imperialists are to enslave economically and politically the European and other capitalist countries and to achieve world domination by means of aggressive war, unquote. Truly, as it was written long ago, the wicked flee when no man pursueth. Yet it is sad to read these Soviet statements to realize the extent of the gulf between us. But it is also a warning to the American people not to fall into the same trap as the Soviets, not to see only a distorted and desperate view of the other side, not to see conflict as inevitable, accommodation as impossible, and communication as nothing more than an exchange of threats. No government or social system is so evil that its people must be considered as lacking in virtue. As Americans, we find communism profoundly repugnant as a negation of personal freedom and dignity. But we can still hail the Russian people for their many achievements in science and space, in economic and industrial growth, in culture, in acts of courage. Among the many traits the peoples of our two countries have in common, none is stronger than our mutual abhorrence of war. Almost unique, among the major world powers, we have never been at war with each other. And no nation in the history of battle ever suffered more than the Soviet Union in the Second World War. At least 20 million lost their lives. Countless millions of homes and families were burned or sacked. A third of the nation's territory, including two-thirds of its industrial base, was turned into a wasteland, a loss equivalent to the destruction of this country east of Chicago. Today, should total war ever break out again, no matter how, our two countries will be the primary target. It is an ironic but accurate fact that the two strongest powers are the two in the most danger of devastation. All we have built, all we have worked for, would be destroyed in the first 24 hours. And even in the Cold War, which brings burdens and dangers to so many countries, including this nation's closest allies, our two countries bear the heaviest burdens. For we are both devoting massive sums of money to weapons that could be better devoted to combat ignorance, poverty, and disease. We are both caught up in a vicious and dangerous cycle, with suspicion on one side breeding suspicion on the other, and new weapons begetting counterweapons. In short, both the United States and its allies, and the Soviet Union and its allies, have a mutually deep interest in a just and genuine peace and in halting the arms race. Agreements to this end are in the interests of the Soviet Union as well as ours. And even the most hostile nations can be relied upon to accept and keep those treaty obligations, and only those treaty obligations, which are in their own interest. So let us not be blind to our differences, but let us also direct attention to our common interests and the means by which those differences can be resolved. And if we cannot end now our differences, at least we can help make the world safe for diversity. For in the final analysis, our most basic common link is that we all inhabit this small planet. We all breathe the same air. We all cherish our children's futures, and we are all mortal. Third, let us re-examine our attitude towards the Cold War, remembering we're not engaged in a debate, seeking to pile up debating points. We are not here distributing blame or pointing the finger of judgment. We must deal with the world as it is, and not as it might have been had the history of the last 18 years been different. We must therefore persevere in the search for peace in the hope that constructive changes within the communist bloc might bring within reach solutions which now seem beyond us. We must conduct our affairs in such a way that it becomes in the communist interest to agree on a genuine peace, and above all, while defending our own vital interests, nuclear powers must avert those confrontations which bring an adversary to a choice of either a humiliating retreat or a nuclear war. To adopt that kind of course in the nuclear age would be evidence only of the bankruptcy of our policy or of a collective death wish for the world. To secure these ends, America's weapons are non-provocative, carefully controlled, designed to deter, and capable of selective use. Our military forces are committed to peace and disciplined in self-restraint. Our diplomats are instructed to avoid unnecessary irritants and purely rhetorical hostility, for we can seek a relaxation of tensions without relaxing our guard. And for our part, we do not need to use threats to prove we are resolute. We do not need to jam foreign broadcasts out of fear our faith will be eroded. We are unwilling to impose our system on any unwilling people, but we are willing and able to engage in peaceful competition with any people on earth. Meanwhile, we seek to strengthen the United Nations to help solve its financial problems, to make it a more effective instrument for peace, to develop it into a genuine world security system, a system capable of resolving disputes on the basis of law, of ensuring the security of the large and the small, and of creating conditions under which arms can finally be abolished. At the same time, we seek to keep peace inside the non-communist world, where many nations, all of them our friends, are divided over issues which weaken Western unity, which invite communist intervention, or which threaten to erupt into war. Our efforts in West New Guinea, in the Congo, in the Middle East, and the Indian subcontinent have been persistent and patient, despite criticism from both sides. We have also tried to set an example for others by seeking to adjust small but significant differences with our own closest neighbors in Mexico and Canada. Speaking of other nations, I wish to make one point clear. We are bound to many nations by alliances. These alliances exist because our concern and theirs substantially overlap. Our commitment to defend Western Europe and West Berlin, for example, stands undiminished because of the identity of our vital interests. The United States will make no deal with the Soviet Union at the expense of other nations and other peoples, not merely because they are our partners, but also because their interests and ours converge. Our interests converge, however, not only in defending the frontiers of freedom, but in pursuing the paths of peace. It is our hope and the purpose of Allied policy to convince the Soviet Union that she too should let each nation choose its own future, so long as that choice does not interfere with the choices of others. The communist drive to impose their political and economic system on others is the primary cause of world tension today. For there can be no doubt that if all nations could refrain from interfering in the self-determination of others, the peace would be much more assured. This will require a new effort to achieve world law, a new context for world discussions. It will require increased understanding between the Soviets and ourselves. An increased understanding will require increased contact and communication. One step in this direction is the proposed arrangement for a direct line between Moscow and Washington to avoid on each side the dangerous delays, misunderstandings, and misreadings of others' actions which might occur at a time of crisis. We have also been talking in Geneva about our first step measures of arms controls, designed to limit the intensity of the arms race and reduce the risk of accidental war. Our primary long-range interest in Geneva, however, is general and complete disarmament, designed to take place by stages, permitting parallel political developments to build the new institutions of peace, which would take the place of arms. The pursuit of disarmament has been an effort of this government since the 1920s. It has been urgently sought by the past three administrations. And however dim the prospects are today, we intend to continue this effort, to continue it in order that all countries, including our own, can better grasp what the problems and the possibilities of disarmament are. The only major area of these negotiations where the end is in sight, yet where a fresh start is badly needed, is in a treaty to outlaw nuclear tests. The conclusion of such a treaty, so near and yet so far, would check the spiraling arms race in one of its most dangerous areas. It would place the nuclear powers in a position to deal more effectively with one of the greatest hazards which man faces in 1963, the further spread of nuclear arms. It would increase our security. It would decrease the prospects of war. Surely this goal is sufficiently important to require our steady pursuit, yielding neither to the temptation to give up the whole effort, nor the temptation to give up our insistence on vital and responsible safeguards. I'm taking this opportunity, therefore, to announce two important decisions in this regard. First, Chairman Khrushchev, Prime Minister McMillan, and I have agreed that high-level discussions will shortly begin in Moscow, looking towards early agreement on a comprehensive test ban treaty. Our hope must be tempered. Our hopes must be tempered with the caution of history, but with our hopes go the hopes of all mankind. Second, to make clear our good faith and solemn convictions on this matter, I now declare that the United States does not propose to conduct nuclear tests in the atmosphere so long as other states do not do so. We will not be the first to resume. Such a declaration is no substitute for a formal binding treaty, but I hope it will help us achieve one. Nor would such a treaty be a substitute for disarmament, but I hope it will help us achieve it. Finally, my fellow Americans, let us examine our attitude towards peace and freedom here at home. The quality and spirit of our own society must justify and support our efforts abroad. We must show it in the dedication of our own lives, as many of you who are graduating today will have an opportunity to do by serving without pay in the Peace Corps abroad or in the proposed National Service Corps here at home. But wherever we are, we must all, in our daily lives, live up to the age-old faith that peace and freedom walk together. In too many of our cities today, the peace is not secure because freedom is incomplete. It is the responsibility of the executive branch at all levels of government, local, state, and national, to provide and protect that freedom for all of our citizens by all means within our authority. It is the responsibility of the legislative branch at all levels, wherever the authority is not now adequate, to make it adequate. And it is the responsibility of all citizens in all sections of this country to respect the rights of others and respect the law of the land. All this is not unrelated to world peace. When a man's way please the Lord, the scriptures tell us, he maketh even his enemies to be at peace with him. And is not peace, in the last analysis, basically a matter of human rights, the right to live out our lives without fear of devastation, the right to breathe air as nature provided it, the right of future generations to a healthy existence? While we proceed to safeguard our national interests, let us also safeguard human interests. And the elimination of war and arms is clearly in the interests of both. No treaty, however much it may be to the advantage of all, however tightly it may be worded, can provide absolute security against the risks of deception and evasion. But it can, if it is sufficiently effective in its enforcement, and it is sufficiently in the interest of its signers, offer far more security and far fewer risks than an unabated, uncontrolled, unpredictable arms race. The United States, as the world knows, will never start a war. We do not want a war. We do not now expect a war. This generation of Americans has already had enough, more than enough, of war and hate and oppression. We shall be prepared if others wish it. We shall be alert to try to stop it. But we shall also do our part to build a world of peace where the weak are safe and the strong are just. We are not helpless before that task, or hopeless of its success. Confident and unafraid, we must labor on, not towards a strategy of annihilation, but towards a strategy of peace.
Well, again, thanks everyone for joining us, and thanks for Jeffrey Sachs, who's here with us. I'm not going to say much about Jeffrey. People are very familiar with him, other than the fact that 10 years ago, he wrote a book on this speech and JFK called To Move the World, JFK's Quest for Peace. Very, very important book. And the other thing I would say is that one of the only people I know who's listened to this speech and read it more times than me. So take it away, Jeffrey.
Martin, thank you so much. Greetings to friends around the world. It's true, I could listen to it every day, and I just relished listening to it again just now together with you. Almost exactly 60 years to the moment, in fact, including obviously to the day that it was given on June 10, 1963. It is one of the greatest speeches of modern history, one of the most important speeches of modern history, and one of the most pertinent speeches for us today, for our very survival today. As Martin said, I wrote a book about the speech 10 years ago to commemorate the 50th anniversary of the speech, because I thought that its general principles were so important and the eloquence of the speech was so great that it needed a celebration. Today, 60 years from the day of the speech, we need to understand it precisely, because we are right now again at the brink of nuclear war. And those who say that we are not don't understand the world that we live in, don't understand the dangers that we face, don't understand the path of escalation in Ukraine, which has been a path of bluff and then counter bluff and then escalation and counter escalation, not for the year plus since Russia's invasion on February 24th, 2022 took place, but for more than 30 years. I've seen at least some of it with my own eyes because I was an advisor to the economic team of President Mikhail Gorbachev. I was an advisor to President Boris Yeltsin. I was an advisor to President Leonid Kuchma, the first president of independent Ukraine. And I remember those days, and I've watched how, I'm sad to say, United States policies have wrecked the hopes of those days and put us on a path that now is causing shocking and shockingly dangerous devastation in Ukraine. So this speech is so much more relevant today than 10 years ago. And we need to understand what President Kennedy was telling us. Now, let me describe just a bit about the historical context of this speech. President Kennedy, in my view, was one of the great statesmen of the modern age. But the presidency is a very hard job, and President Kennedy came in fully committed to maintaining the peace, and yet because of the nature of U.S. politics and U.S. governance, and because of the nature of the Cold War in those days, nearly stumbled into nuclear annihilation, because that threat is hovering over the world in the modern time. And we don't eliminate it by closing our eyes or pretending it isn't. And as I've said, the Ukraine crisis has brought us dramatically close to disaster. So President Kennedy came into office, of course, on January 20th, 1961, and gave one of the marvelous inaugural addresses that we remember to this day. And one of the messages in the inaugural address was, let us never negotiate out of fear, but let us never fear to negotiate. So President Kennedy came in determined to find a way to peace at the height of the Cold War. But the tensions were enormous at that time. And two are worth bearing in mind to understand the historical context of the speech. One was the general context of the Cold War itself, which is that there never was a peace agreement after World War II, after Nazi Germany's unconditional surrender in May 1945. There was never a peace agreement or peace framework agreed. And what that meant was that the status of Germany was never determined. Germany in 1945 was occupied by the four victorious powers, the United States, Britain, France, and Russia, or I should say the Soviet Union, excuse me. Those four powers divided Germany and they divided Berlin, the capital of Germany under the Nazi regime. And there was no agreement about what to do with Germany. The United States decided soon after the end of the war that Germany should be remilitarized. This was shocking to the Soviet Union, which had lost more than 20 million citizens to Nazi war making. And the Soviet Union was aiming for can you hear me again?
Yes.
Hello? Yes. Yeah, sorry. I don't know why it dropped, but I'm back. The Soviet Union was aiming for demilitarization of Germany or neutrality of Germany, but the United States decided that Germany would be remilitarized and would be the bulwark of a new US-led military alliance, NATO, the North Atlantic Treaty Organization. This was never accepted by the Soviet Union, which pressed for some kind of resolution that would directly address Soviet security concerns. In 1955, just as a point of background, the Soviet Union, which was occupying part of Austria, agreed to withdraw its troops from the occupying zones of Austria in return for Austria's declaration of neutrality. And the Soviet leadership wanted to show to the United States and to the so-called Western world or the NATO countries that if Germany would be neutral rather than a NATO militarized country, the Soviet Union would withdraw not only from East Germany, but presumably from Central and Eastern Europe as well, because its security concerns would have been addressed. The United States would have nothing of it, however. Austria proved over the succeeding decades that neutrality was a marvelous solution for Austria, but the United States rejects the idea of neutrality in general. The United States wants NATO to be present in as many places as possible. So this was never settled with regard to Germany. At the end of the 1950s, the German leader, Chancellor Adenauer, started to seek nuclear weapons. And Eisenhower was not really against that. And so there was talk about expanded access to nuclear weapons. The Soviet Union leadership was horrified. This ratcheted up the sense of conflict. I could go on at length and should, if we had the time, to explain why by the time President Kennedy came into office, we were at the height of the Cold War. Just to say that President Eisenhower and Soviet Chairman Nikita Khrushchev were scheduled to have a summit in the final year of President Eisenhower's presidency, but the CIA flew a spy plane over the Soviet Union. The spy plane, the so-called U-2 spy plane, was shot down. The CIA, as is so often the case, either lied to the president or made a misjudgment, but told Eisenhower there's no way that the pilot could have survived or that the plane could have survived. Eisenhower went out, and when the Soviet Union claimed that it was being spied on by a U.S. plane, Eisenhower publicly declared that that was a lie. This was a weather plane that had gone off track from Turkey, at which point the Soviet Union brought out the pilot, Gary Powers, and the plane wreckage and said, "You lied directly to us about utterly sensitive matter." This was the context, and of course the summit was canceled. This was the context in which President Kennedy came into office. Soviet fears over a nuclear Germany, unsolved German issues, and rising tensions. In 1959-60, Fidel Castro also succeeded in toppling the US-backed dictatorship of Batista in Cuba and established a revolutionary government. The United States immediately began plans to overthrow Castro, and Castro appealed for security to the Soviet Union. When we say, our leaders say today, any country can choose any allies, this is not exactly how Eisenhower regarded Castro's approach to the Soviet Union. Eisenhower gave the order to the CIA to devise a plan to overthrow Castro. And that plan landed on President Kennedy's desk in early 1961. That, of course, was the so-called Bay of Pigs invasion. President Kennedy was extremely wary and skeptical of this plan. But as a new president, he was not in a position, he felt, to countermand a plan that was in the works, that had landed on his desk, and where the CIA was pressing extraordinarily hard for this. The Bay of Pigs invasion of Cuba by the United States was a massive debacle. All of the Cuban refugee troops that were part of the CIA-led invasion were quickly captured or killed on the beach of the Bay of Pigs in Cuba. And Nikita Khrushchev wrote in a back channel to Kennedy, "President Kennedy, there is a illegal piratical act being carried out by your government." President Kennedy unwisely responded by saying, "This has nothing to do with us. This is not our affair." Nikita Khrushchev wrote back and said, "Don't lie again." The United States lied twice to the Soviet Union on matters of fundamental significance within a very short period of time. When you combine the U.S. invasion of Cuba and the tensions over Germany, this meant that when Khrushchev and Kennedy met at their summit in the spring of 1961, this was an extraordinarily tense and difficult meeting, and Khrushchev gave Kennedy a very hard time. This was followed by the Berlin Wall going up in the summer of 1961. And of course, Khrushchev's decision, extraordinarily unwise, reckless, to put offensive nuclear weapons into Cuba. And Khrushchev was aiming not at war. He was aiming at showing the US a taste of its own medicine. The US had nuclear weapons in Turkey, near to the Soviet Union. The US had invaded Cuba. The US had not listened to Soviet concerns over a nuclear Germany. Khrushchev aimed to make a point. What a terrible way to do it. Because of course, when the shipments of these missiles and their placement in Cuba was discovered by U-2 flights over Cuba in October 1962, they nearly led to full-scale nuclear war. A point that I think is extremely important to appreciate is that almost every advisor of President Kennedy in the early days of the Cuban Missile Crisis said to attack, said that only a military solution could work. There were very, very few advisors calling for a peaceful solution. One notable advisor was UN ambassador, or the US ambassador to the UN, Adlai Stevenson. The history of the Cuban Missile Crisis, incidentally, has never been told better than by the great late historian Martin Sherwin in Sherwin's final book before his very sad death in 2021, a book called Gambling with Armageddon. And I recommend that everybody read it. It's startling and so relevant again, because we have a government that is gambling with Armageddon right now in the United States. Well, of course, we're here 60 years after the speech and nearly 61 years or 60 and a half years after the Cuban Missile Crisis, because Kennedy decided on a diplomatic approach, not a war, not a military attack on Cuba. And it was Kennedy's diplomatic approach and fundamentally a compromise where the U.S. withdrew its missiles from Turkey and the Soviet Union withdrew its missiles from Cuba, and the United States pledged never again to invade Cuba, that the Cuban Missile Crisis was brought to an end. Or I should say nearly so, because there's one more thing to know about the Cuban Missile Crisis, and then I'll get to the speech and its relevance for today. After Kennedy and Khrushchev agreed on unwinding the crisis, after a disabled Soviet submarine near the bottom of the Caribbean thought that it was being attacked by U.S. Navy pilots dropping depth charges and live grenades, apparently, on the submarine. And the captain of the submarine ordered the firing of a nuclear-tipped torpedo. Under U.S. military doctrine of that day, October 27th, 1962, had that nuclear-tipped torpedo been fired, it was the doctrine of the United States, championed by reckless generals such as Curtis LeMay, that the U.S. would unleash a full, unconstrained nuclear attack against the Soviet Union and all countries deemed by the United States to be in the Soviet camp, meaning Central and Eastern Europe and China. The estimates of the Pentagon were that such a full-scale attack would have killed 700 million people. That was the U.S. plan. Of course, we found out later from Carl Sagan and other scientists that it would have killed all of humanity by creating a nuclear winter. When the captain ordered the nuclear submarine torpedo to be fired, the order was countermanded by the commodore of the squadron, by the person who saved the world that you never heard of, Vasily Arkhipov, who said, "No, we will surface, we will not fire the submarine." This event for me illustrates, epitomizes our fate. We are subject to self-made annihilation by accident, by mistake, by insanity, by cruelty, by miscalculation, by calculation. And we don't understand it to this day, how dangerous and reckless our own actions are. So, the speech. In the aftermath of all of this, Kennedy, who came into office to be a peacemaker, embarked on one of the greatest acts of statesmanship in modern history. And the final year of Kennedy's life was a year of miracles. He led the peaceful end of the Cuban Missile Crisis. He and Khrushchev wrote to each other, and Khrushchev was also a man of peace, They wrote to each other saying, "We must pull back from the brink. We cannot go on this way." And Kennedy embarked on a year of peacemaking that was a mix of vision, political genius, and statesmanship of the highest order. Because making peace at the height of the Cold War, in the immediate aftermath of the Cuban Missile Crisis, required a deftness and skill and bravery that is almost unimaginable. This speech that we just listened to on June 10, 1963, was part of that peace campaign. And what you heard, and what always gives me shivers listening to it, is that this speech is directed to Americans, not to the Soviet Union. It's not demands. It's not blustering. As Kennedy himself says, it's not racking up debating points. It is saying to the American people, we need to make peace, and we can make peace because our counterparts want peace too. They are human beings. They are not devoid of virtues. And Kennedy, of course, says that we should hail the Russian people for their achievements in science and in the arts and in space. He humanizes the other side, exactly the opposite of what we get every day from the New York Times, the Washington Post, the Wall Street Journal, our so-called mainstream media, with their warmongers, their reckless reporters, their desire to humiliate the other side. Kennedy aimed to humanize the other side because he said they want peace like we do. And therefore, even our adversaries will abide by agreements in their interest, and peace is in their interest. When Nikita Khrushchev read the speech the next day, June 11, 1963, he immediately ordered that it be published in Pravda and Izvestia and carried over the radio and broadcast as widely as possible throughout the Soviet Union with no changes or edits. He called the U.S. envoy, President Kennedy's envoy to Russia, Avril Harriman, and told Avril Harriman, "I want to make peace with your president. This is the finest speech since Franklin Delano Roosevelt." And within 5 weeks, the two parties signed the Partial Nuclear Test Ban Treaty. 5 weeks later, President Kennedy then took the peace campaign to the American people, because the generals, the military-industrial complex, was either passively, aggressively, aggressively opposed to this kind of peacemaking. President Kennedy went out to the West and gave speeches around the Western states. And even as the generals were casting doubt and skepticism on the treaty, the American people were rallied to the cause of peace. And when the vote in the U.S. Senate came, it was 80-19 in favor of ratification. President Kennedy's last great speech to the world was to celebrate this achievement, this treaty, when President Kennedy spoke to world leaders at the United Nations General Assembly in September 1963, just weeks before his assassination. And I used words from that wonderful speech as the title for my book 10 years ago, To Move the World, because President Kennedy said, and I paraphrase, when looking out from the podium of the UN to all the world leaders assembled in the the General Assembly room of the UN. President Kennedy told them that Archimedes was said to have told his friends, "Give me a place where I can stand and I can move the world," explaining the principle of the lever. And then President Kennedy looked out to the world leaders and said, "Fellow citizens of the world, let us take our stand at this time and in this place to see if we can help move the world toward peace." And of course he did, and then was killed a few weeks later. Many people, including myself, believe that it was because of his peace initiative, probably rogue elements of the US government, perhaps the CIA and others. Of course, we don't know for sure. But in any event, President Kennedy had achieved the ultimate in global statesmanship and in peacemaking. And as the Beatitude says, blessed are the peacemakers. Well, what President Kennedy taught us about making peace in that speech is absolutely directly relevant for us today. First, he said, do not dehumanize or denigrate the other side. They are human beings. They want peace the same way we do. He said, communicate. And I keep hoping. President Biden, pick up the phone, send a Zoom link, talk to your counterpart, talk to Vladimir Putin. Stop the sound bites. Stop the finger pointing, because those of us who know the whole history of this conflict, which goes back more than 30 years, knows how many times the United States has provoked this war. Pick up the phone and negotiate. And President Kennedy said words that are so relevant that I want to remind us of. And he used an important phrase in all of the speech. He said, above all, in other words, the most important message, above all, while defending our own vital interests, nuclear powers must avert those confrontations which bring an adversary to a choice of either a humiliating retreat or a nuclear war. To adopt that kind of course in the nuclear age would be evidence only of the bankruptcy of our policy or of a collective death wish for the world. Above all, do not force a nuclear adversary into a choice between a humiliating defeat or the use of nuclear arms. It is so obvious to any experienced person in this, and I've watched this personally for more than 30 years close up, that there is no military route to Ukraine's security, because if we were to put Russia in the choice of a humiliating defeat or nuclear war, for example, the conquest by force over Crimea, rather than negotiating, we will do exactly what President Kennedy tells us would be a death wish for humanity. President Obama understood this in 2014. Even though President Obama unwisely, very unwisely, and Hillary Clinton very unwisely, and Victoria Nuland directly when she was Assistant Secretary of State, participated in the violent overthrow of the Ukraine president. President Obama knew, do not put this onto a path of war, because he said at the time, Russia has escalatory dominance, meaning that if we escalate, they will escalate. If we escalate, they will escalate. And because the issues facing Russia are perceived by Russia to be fundamental to Russia's national security, and that is the opposition to having a US-led military alliance expand to the 2,000 kilometer border with Russia, that Russia would escalate to nuclear arms if necessary. So Obama was smart not to start on that path. But ladies and gentlemen, we are on that path now because President Biden, Victoria Nuland, who was promoted from her role in the overthrow of Yanukovych to being Under Secretary of State, Jake Sullivan, who was part of that story, who is now not the National Security Advisor to the Vice President, but the National Security Advisor to the President of the United States, have been on the path of pushing NATO enlargement, irrespective of reckless risk, irrespective of Russian red lines. Even last week, the Washington Post ran a story, which was shocking, but in our benumbed media environment, passed without notice. The story said Biden continues, in fact, more and more ignores Russia's red lines. And then a lot of reckless voices of the Washington military-industrial establishment, the military-industrial complex, were quoted as saying, yes, that's bluff, that's bluff, they keep going, rather than we get closer and closer to nuclear war. So this is where President Kennedy's speech is of fundamental and inestimable value to us today. For more than 30 years, the United States has pressed relentlessly an idea of expanding NATO in order to surround Russia in the Black Sea region. The whole idea was to bring Ukraine and Georgia into NATO so that there would be a ring surrounding Russia, including Ukraine, Romania, Bulgaria, Turkey, and Georgia. This was spelled out already in the late 1990s, and apparently it was on the planning books, from what I'm told by historians, already in 1992. And now we are at war, and we are a deep threat, and we have not seen peacemaking. We haven't even seen communication. All we know about diplomacy is that at the end of 2021, when President Putin put on the table a draft U.S.-Russia security agreement based on NATO non-enlargement, the United States said that is non-negotiable. It's none of your business where NATO goes. Then in March 2022, a few weeks after the Russian invasion, but mind you, 8 years after the real start of the war with the violent overthrow of Yanukovych, but a few weeks after the February 24th invasion, Russia and Ukraine were at the negotiating table, with Turkey being mediator, and they were close to an agreement based on Ukraine's neutrality, and the United States blocked it. So until today, the United States has done the opposite of never fear to negotiate. Thank you very much for bringing us together to heed the wisdom of President Kennedy. His wisdom can keep the world alive and safe, and we need to act on it. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much. We wanted to give people in the audience a chance to ask some questions. And so if people want to raise their hand so we can recognize Okay. Mar, let's see, how do we do this? Are you going to unmute the person or can you, Renee, can you unmute yourself? Try unmuting yourself.
Did that work?
Yeah.
Okay. Thank you very much. Well, very nice to have a chance to speak with you on this occasion, Dr. Sachs. And I want you to know also that yesterday I had a chance to watch you and your friends from the Italian Forum.
Oh, good. Thank you.
And I was very. I hope everybody who's on this today would have a chance to hear Carrie, Mrs. Sorensen, and Nina, to hear what they had to say. They really moved my soul. And I applaud you for the way that you are seeing yourself as the voice of the soul of President Kennedy. I think you're doing a terrific job. So I have to, after complimenting you, I have two very controversial questions to ask you.
Go for it.
So I'm associated with the Schiller Institute.
Yes.
I've been associated with the founder of it, Helga LaRouche, and her husband, Lyndon LaRouche, since I was 19 years old, and met the LaRouche movement at Swarthmore College. And I've spent my life, I'm now 71 years old. So it gives you an idea. This has been an intense battle. And also, by the way, Dr. Schatz, it's really wonderful also to hear from you. I've been reading some of your interviews from the 1960s. And you and what Dr. Sachs are doing is really giving a chance for people to find out the real history, which of course Vladimir Putin asked us all to do about a year and a half ago or 2 years ago when he said, I'm declassifying all the documents in the Soviet Union on this question of how World War II happened. And I hope others will take advantage of this and that you will do the same, because we've got to get to the bottom about how such a thing could have occurred. There's a lot that's unknown. So I think we're also responding to his offer, which is very generous. So my two questions, maybe they're not as controversial as I think, but Mrs. LaRouche just founded, this was the catalyst for pulling together a coalition of peace movements from all over the world, because we have to move very fast. We must move very, very fast and change the environment. We can't get involved in electoral politics. That would be national suicide, because people respond to all the, they try to work from the minor issues up to the major issues. We've got to start from the question that stopping the danger of nuclear war is the most important thing. So we want to be able to really work with you. And I'd like to set up a back channel to make sure that we can all talk to each other regularly. And I'm asking you publicly, I'm not expecting you to give me your phone number like this, you know, publicly, but I'm just saying we need to know that we can reach you, because it's, you know, and the reason that that's an issue, if people are surprised that I would say such a thing publicly, is you know how much Lyndon LaRouche has been massively demonized. I understand you're a friend of Dr. Sergei Glazyev in Russia. I've seen public comments. His father-in-law was among the community of scientists in Russia who, after the fall of the wall, invited Mr. LaRouche innumerable times to come to Russia and discuss with them what you, as an economist, have so much to offer as well, which is that ultimately the way we're going to secure peace is by the new economic policy that's coming into being around the BRICS, what people call de-dollarization, as if it's a threat to us. It's not a threat to us, it's salvation to a revised system that would allow economic development everywhere, including of public health. And that would create trust, and then peace would be secured. And that's what Mr. LaRouche worked on, and that's why he was demonized. So would you be willing to comment on, number one, coordination and with the international peace movement, and number two, would you say something about the demonization of Lyndon LaRouche, and why the documents pertaining to what the Justice Department did to him should also be declassified, not just the Kennedy documents. They should be declassified, and people should see the power of the military-industrial complex and the media in brainwashing our fellow citizens. So those are my two questions.
Great. Well, first, we need an international peace movement. And by the way, it's taking shape. There's no question about it. I was on a call earlier today with a meeting in Vienna, and there were representatives from Latin America, from India, from many, many other countries. And one of the persuasive things, a wonderful scholar in India spoke about the fact that there is actually a broad consciousness of peace among the so-called non-West, or I don't like the term global South too much, but in any event, most of the world sees things quite clearly, which is they don't want proxy wars between the United States and Russia. They're dangerous for the whole world, of course. On the second issue, I don't know any of the facts. What I do know is so much is classified that should not be classified. We're revisiting that issue just now. The secrecy is horrendous. My experience, by the way, over 40 years is how relentlessly the United States government lies about so many things. It's shocking to me. On the specific issue that you mentioned, by the way, which I would like to say a word about de-dollarization, the United States has weaponized the dollar, which is so reckless. And what that means is we, of course, confiscated the foreign exchange reserves of Russia, $300 billion reportedly. We did the same with Venezuela because we were trying to overthrow Maduro. We did the same with several other governments. Well, after a while, people don't want to use the dollar if it means it's going to get taken away from you if somehow the United States government doesn't like the way you're dealing. So there will be a de-dollarization over time, for sure. This is already happening very fast, by the way. Russia, China, South Africa, Brazil, many countries, Saudi Arabia, are moving to non-dollar currencies for settlements. Rupees, rubles, renminbi, and others. And so this is happening as a direct result of the United States trying not only to have the dollar used as a means of settlement, but as a principal weapon of foreign policy, which I regard as absolutely self-defeating and doomed to fail.
Okay, thank you. I'm just going to ask people to, we only have about less than 20 more minutes with Jeff because he has a very busy day today. So if you can make your questions brief, if possible, to let as many people as possible participate. Miles, you want to unmute yourself? Go ahead.
Yeah. Okay, Donatada Tansi, hello and greetings from Treaty 7 territory, also known as Alberta, Canada, land of the Niitsitapi, the Blackfoot Confederacy. The word attitude is used in the speech, and President Kennedy calls us to re-examine our attitude as individuals and as nations. Here in Canada, we are seeking reconciliation with the First Nations, the Indigenous peoples. And Senator Sinclair, who is the Commissioner of Truth and Reconciliation Commission, said it all comes down to three things. He wants me to be his friend. He wants me to educate myself and respect all creation stories. And I hear these same calls in President Kennedy's speech. Respect all creation stories means to see every person, individual, as a creation story. They're a creation of a higher power. So there's so much you've given us to work with here today to complement the peace speech. And I'd like to thank you for that. And, the banality of evil, if you might speak to this, it comes down, I'm thinking, to ignorance. You know, if I'm offering to be your friend, but you ignore me, and then if you refuse to educate, you're being incredulous. And finally, not respecting creation stories means you're being passive to life itself. And Sheldon Wolin said, passivity will be the downfall of civilization. Thank you again.
Miles,
any comments?
Miles, thank you very much. Just to tell you, in the Vienna meeting a few hours ago, the vice president of Bolivia, Aymara, indigenous leader, spoke of this time being the 10th Pachacuti in the Aymara cosmology, and that this was a time for global reconciliation and peace and rebasing. So this was exactly his theme, what you have just mentioned. So I really appreciate that. Let me tell you, 30 years ago, as I said briefly, I was an economic advisor to Gorbachev, to Yeltsin, and to Kuchma. I had one goal, and they saw me as one hope, which was to help bring some financial, urgent financial support in an environment of economic collapse, because the end of the Soviet era was a dramatic economic collapse, and I wanted the Western world to ease the pain by providing a financial floor so that recovery could start and reconstruction could start. And the United States absolutely was uninterested. And it was a case of not being able to take yes for an answer, because President Gorbachev said, we want to be peaceful, normal. President Yeltsin said many times to me and in my presence, we want to just be a normal country with normal neighbors. But the United States neocons, already back in 1992, Wolfowitz, Cheney, Rumsfeld, and then of course it went on to Newland and many, many others, said, no, that's our enemy. We have to make sure that any potential adversary is brought low. I believe, I didn't understand it at the time, how reckless, because here was this historic opportunity to be a friend, Miles, like you said. And we just could not accept yes. We couldn't hear it. There was no political imagination, no awareness, no humanity that would have lifted this. We are on what was a completely avoidable crisis. And by the way, our top statesmen knew expanding NATO was reckless. And many, many of our top diplomats said so. And our politicians and the military industrial complex didn't want to hear it.
Thank you. I wanted to just offer something here. And that is, for me, the speech is outlining peace as a process as much as it is a state. And war, by consequently, also war is a process, not just a state. And that if you, based on what you're saying and based on what President Kennedy was saying, we could say the United States has been at war for the past 30 years. It has been, because the Cold War is an aspect of war. It's not part of a peace process. I just wanted to.
And Martin, I think for us, I feel the US has been at war basically every year of my life. I'm 68. My first awareness, I remember the Cuban Missile Crisis. I was not quite 8 years old at the time. But I remember, of course, vividly, and participated already in anti-war demonstrations, the Vietnam War, Cambodia, Laos, the wars of Central America, which were grotesque wars of choice of the United States, the U.S. funding of Iraq to attack Iran in the 1980s, the Gulf War, the war in Afghanistan, which started with the CIA funding the Mujahideen in 1979 to try to attract the Soviet Union to invade. So we created a disaster for Afghanistan that lasted more than 40 years, and in fact, that lasts till today, a country ruined, and the United States, the instigator of that, tragically. And then, since these neocons got the idea that, well, now we're the sole superpower, one of their clear ideas was to topple every regime that they did not like, starting with Afghanistan again in 2001, then Iraq, then Syria in 2011. That was not a Syrian civil war. That was a U.S. regime change operation that has never to this day been explained to the American people, Operation Timber Sycamore, which was signed by President Obama to have the CIA help lead the the violent overthrow of Bashar al-Assad, then the overthrow of Muammar Gaddafi, and the overthrow of Yanukovych, and now the war that we're in today. So when has it ever been at peace? We have a military-industrial complex that Eisenhower warned us about, and it revs. And I came to understand, it took me a long time in my adult life really to understand, the main job of a US president is to keep the foot on the brake, because that war machine is always revving. If you spend $900 billion on the military, people want to use it. They want to test their weapons. They want to show how powerful they are. They want to sell more weapons. And so the job of a US president is put your foot on the brakes. But very, very few presidents get that.
Okay. Lon, you're next. John Lon. Why don't I unmute you?
Okay. Thank you, Marty. I really appreciate what you had to offer us in discussion here today, Jeffrey, and I've tried to follow every YouTube thing that you've had to say in this recent period, and it's been a lot. I really appreciate your basically devoting your life to getting this word out and trying to develop a greater understanding. A lot of what was mentioned in the speech that talked about the process, of trying to get to a place where we weren't spending close to $1 trillion, maybe over $1 trillion every year, that money being taken away from solving the problem of homeless people, addressing health issues that are desperate both here and internationally, and building. Another part of the speech seemed to focus on finding an alternative, because although, as Marty said, you could see war and peace as processes, in a way it's all one process. People say war is, you know, diplomacy, a different thing,
the continuation of politics with other means.
Other means. So of trying to design our politics with a way that we can have peaceful resolutions that people will have confidence in through more international legal structure, strengthening and making more independent the international bodies. So I'm glad to hear about the international peace efforts that are beginning to be constructed. I want to mention, I'm duty bound to mention, the World Peace Council, which is, I'm sure, participating and is a small part of a much larger effort, but has been around for some time, trying to advance that forward. And I wondered from you whether you thought the September speech that you mentioned, given to the United Nations, should be or would be a good additional tool to this American Union speech to try to get across, you know, even more fully the road that Kennedy was on, and would encourage others of us to follow. Thanks, Rob, again.
Thank you. Bravo for that idea. You know, just to say, 60 years ago, this was a campaign that involved many wonderful speeches, and The United Nations General Assembly speech is definitely worth celebrating. And another great speech, incidentally, is the speech that President Kennedy gave to the Irish Parliament in the summer during this period. And he said something that I think is stunningly beautiful and stunningly important in that speech that also I want to share, very relevant for us today. When he spoke to the Irish Parliament in July 1963, he said, "Indeed, across the gulfs and barriers that now divide us, we must remember that there are no permanent enemies. Hostility today is a fact, but it is not a ruling law. The supreme reality of our time is our indivisibility as children of God and our common vulnerability on this planet." So that's another wondrous speech to recall. And we need to keep up the effort. And boy, we need a change of policy in this country, because we are thinking that whatever isn't working, more arms, more F-16s, more escalation, that's going to do it. Of course, that brings us closer and closer to disaster. And let me say one quick word about the economics of this. The Watson Institute at Brown University has done many important studies of the costs of war since 2000, since the year 2000. And the basic estimate that they provide is that the wars in Afghanistan and Iraq principally have cost the United States $6 trillion. Now, with another $2 trillion to come in future veterans' costs of wounded veterans from those wars, $8 trillion in total. This is a very significant proportion of the explosion of public debt that was being debated in recent weeks, but you didn't hear Congress and the president talk about the costs of the war in this context. Indeed, what they decided to do was to cap the civilian discretionary spending, but allow for a significant increase of the military spending. That's what we face right now. We face a military-industrial complex that it assures that the money for the arms race, the money for wars, is protected while everything else is subject to real cuts.
Thank you. Okay, Robin, you're next. Want to unmute yourself? Go ahead.
Yeah.
Do you have a question? Can you unmute? Yeah, go ahead.
I just wanted to know why no one's talking about the underlying causes of our human disasters. Namely, you got sociopaths running most corporations, especially weapon makers, putting terrible pressure on Washington and dominating the media. You got ignorant people like Biden that they don't seem to understand how dangerous malignant narcissists like Putin are. He could do anything if threatened. And then you got the masses of people that are so, you know, gullible conformists and go along with all this. And you got your most closed-minded, nasty personalities become right-wingers. And everyone seems to go along with all this. And can you address some of that?
Let me address part of it. And thanks very much, Robin. I think one thing is really distressing. The way our government increasingly functions during the past 40 years by a kind of hacking of the political system is that various parts of our public policy have been sold off to the various lobbies. So healthcare is sold off to big health. Finance is sold off to Wall Street. Our food system is sold off to big ag, and so forth. This is because we opened up the spigots of political contributions, so-called contributions, really buying government policy, and to billions and billions of dollars of lobbying and revolving doors for jobs and all the rest. Well, foreign policy was sold off to the military-industrial complex. So these choices that are being made are not popular choices. In fact, most people don't believe the media on most things anymore. And by the way, my experience of the mainstream media, the New York Times, the Washington Post, Wall Street Journal, it's so depressingly stupid what they write. So obviously stupid, but they're part of this system. And it's so sad because I remember something better also in my youth when the New York Times would run the Pentagon Papers and so forth and actually have an idea in their heads. So we sold government to the highest bidder. When the question of NATO enlargement came up, who was in charge of the quote campaign for NATO enlargement? It was the Raytheon lobbyist. You can't make this stuff up. It's real. This is how our government works right now. And that is not democracy. That is a kind of plutocracy that has hacked our political system.
Can we take another question? Charlene.
Dr. Sachs, thank you so much for your presence here today and for communicating your sense of urgency to all of us here. I would like to ask you to please talk about the urgency of the United States removing its missiles recently placed in Romania and Poland.
What we need, thank you very much. What President Putin has been saying for actually 20 years now, 21 years, is that the US and Russia need, honestly, to find a security arrangement, because it was 21 years ago that the US unilaterally pulled out of the anti-ballistic missile treaty, the ABM treaty. More recently, the US pulled out of the INF treaty. And we also have entered a new phase of, quote, modernization of our nuclear arsenal. And we don't talk to Russia about these things. And the specifics about NATO enlargement were very specific about missile placements, about the timing of missiles to reach Russia, about the risks of being on each other's borders with the missiles that would reach Russia in minutes, and all of the risks of being on a razor's edge that this would cause. And yet, our answer has been none of your business. We don't need to talk to you about this. And this is where these challenges lie. I am not an expert specifically on all of the missile placements or the weapon systems, but I know that we are not engaging in arms control and diplomacy, to say the least. And what I do know also, everyone on the call knows it well, but if you're interested in lots of fascinating, detailed documents, go to the National Security Archives of George Washington University to see that this NATO enlargement has been in violation of promises that the United States made from the very start to Gorbachev. And then over the strong objections of Russian leaders way before Putin came to power. And by the way, I also know very well that Putin was not an enemy, and he was not anti-European, and he was not anti-American. This is the idea that, you know, this is an implacable foe is historically wrong. We have never been willing to discuss the issues that Russian leaders have said are absolutely a vital concern to their national security. This is our problem. It's arrogance. And incidentally, I went back to read a book that I only vaguely remembered from my junior high school years, I think they were, the book by J. William Fulbright, who in the 1960s was the chairman of the Senate Foreign Relations Committee and a brilliant man. And he wrote a book, I think it's 1966, called The Arrogance of Power. And it was during the Vietnam period. The title always remained with me, but it was only a couple of weeks ago that after many decades, I went back to read it as a grown-up. It's an astoundingly good book. And again, shocking how relevant it is more than a half century later. I have time for just one more, and then I'm going to have to depart, but maybe one more question.
Okay. Todd, your hand is up next.
Slow down mute. Thanks very much for this. I'll make this very quick. You've used the word neocon, which is very appropriate, exactly as you used it. But what I've been seeing here lately with Trump and DeSantis is this invention of the so-called right-wing peaceniks. And if you examine it a little bit closer, which no one ever does, these are the guys, Josh Hawley, Matt Gaetz, they're so eager and demanding war against China. You know, they just want to prioritize war against China, which, you know, whichever way it goes, and you know military doctrine, always includes the other, you know. So if we go to war against China, it's necessarily going to include war against Russia. So I think perhaps you could just address this myth-making that's going on right now, too, of some sort of peacenik right wing. Long before the neocons entered the scene, we had Barry Goldwater, James Burnham, William Buckley inciting war, demanding even more of Eisenhower and of Kennedy, Kennedy's opponents. So I'll stop there, but love to hear any comments on that.
Yeah, Todd, thank you very much. You know, I was in the Senate office buildings a couple of weeks ago and spoke with Rand Paul, whom I like very much in many ways, though I'm in economics, certainly not a libertarian. But he was telling me that just about everybody in the Senate is quite strongly anti-China. So this is bipartisan, both parties, really aggressive language. And that's what I'm observing. That we are creating another extraordinarily dangerous path to an even greater chance of world devastation in a war with China. And so I really appreciate you raising the issue. I'm not going to treat it as a right-wing or democratic issue because I'm observing across the political scene, the rhetoric against China is so wrongheaded, so dangerous, so reckless, so ignorant. I can't imagine it, to tell you the truth. Now, I first went to China in 1981, so 42 years ago. I've been going to China just about every year since then, sometimes many times a year. I have had many Chinese students study at Harvard and at Columbia University under my guidance, who are now senior scholars in China or officials in the Chinese government. Very nice people, very professional people, by the way. We have so little understanding, so little attempt to understand China's perspective. We have so little knowledge of history. I can't even tell you where to start. Maybe we could do another hour or two on China at some point, but I'll tell you, I'll tell you, China has never launched an overseas war. As far as I know, never. China's been engaged in one very short war in the last 45 years and zero in the last 40 years. The one war was a brief war in Vietnam, 40, I think it's 43 or 44 years ago now, very brief, we have been nonstop at war. Mm-hmm. And China, quote, tried to invade Japan once, but that wasn't the Chinese, that was the Mongols who had conquered China. So the Mongols tried to invade Japan in the 13th century, and the fleet was sunk by a typhoon, the so-called kamikaze wind. Japan tried to invade and did invade China on several occasions, but China never the other way around. And yet we are beating the drumbeats about this violent country, this threat to the world, the country that wants global domination. It's so ignorant. It is so devoid of historical understanding. It is so reckless. It is so stupid. It's hard to imagine how this can come, but it's a game. And it's a game because China is a successful, large country, but these United American strategists, so-called, just are playing a game of who's the top of the hill, who's the king of the castle, who's number one. It's worse than school children. Every time I say they act like school children, my wife tells me I'm insulting school children, because there is nothing, there is nothing there that makes us have to have any kind of conflict whatsoever with China. So why is Nancy Pelosi flying to Taiwan over the objections? Why are we integrating Taiwan and the United States military systems just in the most recent days? We have a one China policy. We're breaking it to provoke right now. We're absolutely reckless. We don't talk. It's the same deal. And I'm telling you, this is, for me, mind-boggling, because having been involved in that issue for even longer than with Russia, for more than 40 years, there is no case in the world why we should be in conflict. China doesn't want it. Their living standards, or per capita income, I should say, even at purchasing adjusted prices, are about a third of the United States. They want development. They want quiet. They want trade. They want investment. But no, not the United States. We need to be number one. We need to contain China. We need to make enemies. We need to make threats. And this is heading the same direction, a self-fulfilling prophecy of war. And shame on the Biden administration on this, because Biden has upped the ante on China. And I know it because I see it close up. I have a lot of, they wouldn't call me friends anymore, but I have a lot of very close acquaintances in the administration. This makes no sense what's going on. So I want to assure you that we could have absolutely normal, peaceful relations with China if we move in that direction. Ladies and gentlemen, Thank you very much. Martin, back to you, and then thanks.
And there are a number of questions that we didn't get to. And if you, I will check the chat for questions and actually get some of them to you and see if I can facilitate getting answers back to people in terms of questions they have.
I'll do my best. These days are packed to the brim, but I will do my best. And I want to thank all of you for being peacemakers and peace leaders. Please tell our Congress, get your thinking going again. Understand what's going on. Their job is to keep us safe. They're doing the opposite right now. We don't accept it. We need to make our democracy work, even against the big bucks of the military-industrial complex. And that's exactly what you do. And I'm so grateful.
Thank you. Thanks very much.
Thanks, everybody.
Take care. Also, if I did put my my email in the chat before, I'm going to put it in again. If people wanted to write to me with any of their questions, I'll try and facilitate getting answers for you, and may be helpful to others as well. We're now going to have a musical offering from Sharon Abreu. And I just wanted to say a couple words. Sharon's a member of our JFKP speech committee, but she is also a solo and choral singer, songwriter, and violinist. She is a voice, environmental, and peace educator. As the Earthlings duo, Sharon and her partner, Michael Hurwitz, use music to help audiences imagine a peaceful world and inspire action toward that end in the US. Feeling a strong connection to the 60s through her life, after getting to know JFK's speech, Sharon was moved to set it to music for chorus and soloists. We're going to see a video of some of a performance which was recently done. And just one thing to Amar, Sharon has put in the words beneath the video so that people can follow the words of the singers, which at sometimes might be a little bit difficult. So will you try and facilitate that when you show the video? But I'm going to turn it over to Sharon so she can also offer some introductory remarks. You there, Sharon? Maybe raise your hand electronically and you'll come to the top. Sharon, are you with us? Oh, there we go. Okay. Go ahead.
I got kicked offline at just the wrong moment.
Go ahead.
Yeah. So very briefly, I'd just like to say that it's been an honor to be part of the JFK Peace Speech Group. Mike, can you mute your sound there, please? Mute your audio. It's been a great honor to be a part of this.
I'm sorry, hold on. I'll do it.
JFK Peace Speech Group for about a year and a half now. And I'm very pleased to, I was very inspired to write this choral work around the speech. And I hope you enjoy these excerpts.
I am talking of a genuine peace, the kind of peace that makes life on earth worth living. Genuine peace, the kind that enables people and nations to extent of the gulf.
Our policy, or a collective death wish for hope. misunderstandings and misreadings of the other's actions, which might occur at a time of crisis.
Building new institutions of these to take the place of us.
Finally, my fellow Americans, let us examine our attitude toward peace and freedom here at home.
Confident and
Sharon, thank you so much. And I want to thank everybody who participated today. Please be in touch with us, and we will be getting in touch with you shortly with both the link to this session as well as other materials which you might find of use. So with that, we'll sign off. Take care.